action, I'm smoking these rappers and feeling spectacular. Making a killing like Massacre. Watch out, I'm whipping my wrist. Right on my city, been pissed, but I show them love. I'm not the one that's at risk. My homie told me that when people...
Hello, everyone. This will be the second part of my video series regarding the basic setup of my race car. Today we will be talking about cooling system and fuel system. I also will have to do a third part because it's just too much information and I don't want to do a video 30 minutes long or even longer. So just that you know, there will be a third part covering all the other stuff. And I had some comments and some questions from last time, so I will show you some technical details on the stuff from the last video, and then we will start with the main topics.
There was a question regarding shifter linkage, because the gearbox normally comes with a cable, and the cable is not very good for motorsport purpose in my opinion, so that's why I changed it to rods. You can see here how I did it. Normally the cable attaches to this aluminium bracket here on the gearbox. So as you can see, I cut it and then there's this lever, and I bought a second one of this lever here and welded a plate to the chassis and mounted the second lever at this point. So with this modification you are able to just use two rigid rods instead of the cable, and that's it. It's an easy option, easy solution. You can see here how it moves.
A second technical detail regarding shifting I forgot to mention in the last video is the system you see here. So you see this pressure line and this valve. This goes to the ALDA of the injection pump and also to the bypass of the supercharger. So this is the opening pressure for the bypass. This is a three-way valve. You see the third opening here. When the ignition is on, it's just connected. So this line and this line is connected. There's just a way through here. And as soon as I put my foot on the clutch, this valve gets activated. So this side of the valve is connected to this opening. So the pressure, which formerly was at the bypass and the ALDA, gets released. And this side gets shut off, so it's just closed. That means that the supercharger bypass closes and I get some kind of overboost in the shifting, in the moment of shifting. Formerly, when I didn't have this system, when I shifted, it was very rough. So the pressure dropped down, there was still pressure in the ALDA, so it injected additional fuel. The car started to smoke a lot, and the shifting was a very rough one. So it always felt like a boxer is hitting your back of your head. And with this system now, as I have the overboost during the shifting and the venting of the ALDA, there's no more smoke and the shifting takes place very smoothly. And I'm very happy how this system works. It's just, it was an experiment. I just tried it and it worked out really good. So let's talk about cooling system. I also prepared some schematic views like this one. I think this makes it easier to understand, but also easier for me to explain. And let's go through this one. So the direction of flow, it begins with the pump. The pump is sitting here. There's one modification you can do from original, which is a smaller pulley. It's a pulley from the OM603, as you can see here in this number. And it has a smaller diameter, so more rotation, which means higher flow rate through the block and through the head. So this is one cooling modification, one upgrade you can easily do. I'm using the standard pump, which sits on the block. And then the water flows into the block, up into the head. What I also did, I did the cooling modification which Dieselmaken showed in one of his videos. So there's also cool water coming from the pump directly on the last cylinders. Because as you can also see in this picture, the rear, so the last cylinder is kind of a dead end. Because the water comes in on the front and it also comes out on the front in my case. normally you have here the connection for the heating system, so also water is flowing from the rear side of the cylinder head into the radiator for the heating system, then back into the pump. But in my case, because I don't need a system, I deleted it, and so the rear of the engine becomes kind of a dead end for the heat. So that's why it's also very important to have the temperature sensor on the rear, because this is the most critical point for your heat. And now you understand why the cooling modification is a good thing. You need cold water also coming into the rear, so the cooling is also increased at this area. The water then comes out of the cylinder head and goes into the radiator, and then through the radiator back into the pump. You have a reservoir. I used one from a Mercedes model. You can see the number here. I have some electrical fans from Spal, and they are switched on with the temperature switch. So at a certain temperature, they switch on and switch off again. That's the basic configuration I'm using. The cooling system is a very crucial system from my perspective. I know that people often don't understand why I have such big cooling problems. When I tell them my engine is getting hot, they never understand. They drive higher horsepower numbers in these engines and they don't have cooling problems. But I think it depends on how you use it. Normally those engines get built for highway use, for daily use. So they get a few pulls on the highway and then it's back to driving slow again. The engine has time to get rid of the extra heat and it works fine. But for the track it's a different story. You're constantly accelerating, hard braking. It takes time only shortly and then you are back to accelerating again. So there's so much heat going into the cylinder head because of the pre-chamber principle that it is very, very hard to keep these kind of engines cool in a motorsport purpose. So that's why I take a lot of focus on the cooling system, and this is such an important topic to me. That said, let's have a look on the real components on the car. The most important part, of course, is the radiator. If you are building a pre-chamber engine for the track, which is basically not a good idea because this principle has heat problems, as I told you. So you are better off with a direct injection engine or gasoline engine. If you are stupid like me and want to build such an engine for the track, then buy a big fucking radiator. It can't get too big. It needs to be as big as possible. That's what I have here. I started with a smaller one. I have cooling problems since the beginning. So at one point I said, okay, I need to invest some money and I have to let someone manufacture a big fucking radiator for me. And that's what I have here. The thickness, I think, is 70 millimeters, 75, and it fills up all the space in the front, as you can see. There you can see some piping. Here's the input for the water pump. So the line goes from the bottom of the radiator to the pump. There you can see part of the cooling modification. There's some dash fitting behind the pump inlet and a hose going to the back of the block. There's the inlet for the radiator with the temperature switch, which switches on the electrical fans. Of course, it normally is a good idea to keep the original visco fan, but I had space issues, so I needed to use the electrical fans. The cooling power is not nearly as good as the visco fan, but I actually don't have a choice here. That's it on the water cooling system. Let's move on to the oil cooling system. You also see the schematic view here. Let's start with the pump. I had to upgrade to an OM606 pump because when my oil is very hot at the end of the race, I noticed decreased oil pressure. And I think the reason is also those long lines here. which I needed to relocate my oil cooler. So I upgraded to this pump, which has a higher flow rate, and I think it worked. I couldn't test it 100%, but from what I've seen when I let the engine run here in my workshop, I think the pressure is increased a little bit, but I will find out during the season, hopefully. But let's move on. This is the original oil filter housing, and I made an adapter from the water to oil cooler, which sits originally on the housing. I cut it open, welded some fittings on, so I had an adapter to the dash system, and moved some lines to relocate the oil cooler to this area. And there's also an electrical fan switched on by a temperature switch. And I'm using a universal 25-row oil cooler you can get anywhere on eBay, for example. My dash adapter is unfortunately not good to see because of the intake manifold. But you see the dash fittings here from the oil filter housing. And the lines move this way here, all around the engine and attached to the oil cooler, which sits here. There's also the electrical fan, and the air is going this way through the headlight, so the oil cooler gets fresh and cold air. Some people might ask why I chose this weird position in line with the airflow and not perpendicular to the airflow, which is the normal case. It's because I had no location left, actually. The cooler is pretty big, so it's not easy to locate it somewhere in the wheel housing or on the side. And I didn't want to put it in front of the water radiator because it then has negative influence on my water temperature. So I needed a separate location with a separate airflow, and that's what I found here. Let's move on to the water ethanol injection and application system. This is a little bit more complex, so we have to have a little more detailed view on this picture here. As you can see, I drew in the coolers, this is the water cooler, oil cooler, and here is the intake. There is the reservoir for the water ethanol. We have a filter, a pump, a three-way valve, a two-way valve, and then some nozzles. The pump is building up pressure of the water ethanol in this area. So this three-way valve just connects those lines, so the pressure comes through here. And this valve is the one which controls the injection. This is switched on by a boost switch. So when the boost exceeds a certain amount, this is switched on and injection starts and stops again when the boost is below a certain point. I have nozzles for spraying water on the water cooler, also on the oil cooler. And then I have some specific nozzle which injects the water ethanol into the intake. I will show you afterwards. This valve has a single purpose to release the pressure from this area when the system is shut off. So if this wasn't there, you shut off the system, there's still pressure between the pump and the control valve. So this valve opens the way for the pressure to be released back into the container. That's the only purpose. Here you see the system on the car. There's the container. I used a simple camping container. Put some special tank foam inside so the fluid doesn't move around too much. Then I used some fittings to make the input and output lines. There's the pump. It's covered because it's very loud, so I had to cover it. And some electrical stuff here, and this is the first valve for the venting. Then there's the line going to the front. Let's have a look in the engine compartment. The line is moving this way here. There's the line coming from the inside of the car. Here is the control valve, which gets switched on by the boost switch. The boost switch itself sits here on the intake manifold. It's actually adjustable, so there's a screw inside behind this rubber thing, and you can adjust to a higher or lower boost pressure. I, at the moment, adjusted it to 1.5 bar approximately. Then this is the main line for the water injection. It goes into the input of the engine. And this line goes separate. There's a ball valve where I can choose if I want to have the application or not. And here I have my nozzles. So this one sprays in front of the radiator. This one also in the other direction. And then I have a third one injecting water in front of the oil cooler. It's hard to see. Let's have a look from behind. Maybe you see it here. Yeah, there you see it mounted on the backside. And the nozzle is reaching inside of this channel here. Let's have a short demonstration how the system works. I just disassembled the nozzle here from the intake. So this is a special nozzle from Central Heating Systems for your home. And I'm using 8.0 size. It's also possible to use higher sizes, bigger sizes, but for me this is a good size. And let's test this. Put the nozzle inside this container. I will bridge the pressure switch with this cable. Let's start up the system. I need ignition. Then if I switch on the system, you will hear the pump building up pressure. Now we have 10 bars in the line. So now the pressure is right in front of this valve. And if I bridge, you can also switch on the application system. This will be messy, but whatever. So let's try this. You hear the pump and see a lot of mist coming out. And a lot of stuff here also. Last but not least, let's move on to the fuel system. I have a two-tank system. On the right side you see the main fuel tank, which is a real racing fuel tank. Then there is a pump. I'm using a China version of the 044, the famous Bosch pump. And I have a small catch tank, which prevents that air bubbles get caught in this side of the system. A second pump, which moves the fuel from the catch tank to the injection pump, and then of course a pressure regulator to keep the pressure in the injection pump at the right level, and then the return lines. Let's have a look on the real system. I just had to remove this cover here from the tank compartment, and now you see the system. There's the pump and filter package, the racing fuel cell and the catch tank. And I just realized in my picture there's a mistake. The fuel filter is afterwards, after the catch tank. So from this line, this is the main fuel line, it goes to the first pump, from the first pump to the catch tank, from the catch tank back again to the second pump, then in the filter and then underneath the car to the engine compartment. In the engine compartment there's not much to see. The lines arrive here underneath. It's too dark, you won't see it, but the only thing to be seen from the fuel system is this pressure regulator here. And that's it. There's the return line from the injection pump. So this is the pressure side, then this is the low pressure side. And there's also the return line from the injectors, and this is the return line back to the tank. I again hope this was an interesting video for you. Feel free to make any suggestions what to show in the next one. I already have a rough concept, but if you have some specific details you want to see, just write it down and I will cover it with my third part of this video series. So thanks for watching and see you in the next video.